Hello, I'd like to call to order the Bothell Planning Commission for this evening, Wednesday, October 26th at 7 p.m. All of the commissioners are here and accounted for, with the exception of Commissioner Cecil, who I haven't heard from, but he's probably on his way with the weather coming this way. And there's nobody in the public, so there'll be no non-agenda public comments, looks like. No minutes to approve. And is there any new business?
None.
And there's no public hearing tonight. And so with that, we will go ahead and open the study session. The study session tonight is regarding the code amendments to implement a clustering mechanism within the Bothell Municipal Code. And with that, I'll hand it over to Senior Planner Bruce Blackburn.
Thank you. I'm going to go ahead and do a little presentation, just, you know, kind of give us a little bit of a background on what's going on here, of course. This evening's study is about a clustering mechanism that would basically introduce clustering throughout the city. And it would basically be one of those things that where you'd have, and clustering is a practice where the footprint of the overall development or the envelope of the development is reduced in exchange for preservation of forest areas, other types of open space, or other types of items that is identified by the city. Now, the City Council initiated this as a potential code amendment in February of 2016, and basically identified that they wanted the commission to look at potential clustering ordinance and do this during the 2016 docket year, and that's why we're here tonight. There is a companion clustering mechanism that is currently being investigated by the City Council, and that involves an area of the city called the Fitzgerald 35th Avenue subarea. And that's also within lands called the North Creek Fish and Wildlife Critical Habitat Protection Area, the NCFA CHOPA, and is specifically identified as the LID overlay. And the council is investigating a clustering mechanism that would apply to that subarea, or maybe even a portion of that subarea. Now, that clustering mechanism is kind of have a focus on an environmental stream system groundwater preservation aspect, whereas and it'd also be linked to low impact development techniques. Basically, that is surface water runoff facilities that more closely duplicate a forest hydrology. So there are kind of two clustering discussions going on right now. Of course, one is the Fitzgeralds before this council, and of course, this one, which is before the commission. Now, the impetus for this was during the 2016 comprehensive plan amendment process, there was some work being done on the Nike Hill or Shelton View activity area. And essentially what happened was that we had a couple property owners who had submitted comprehensive plan amendment requests as part of the 2015 periodic plan and code update. However, because of a bunch of work tasks and the complexity of those things, we were not able to get that done for that action. So it was basically put to 2016. And during the deliberations the Planning Commission had on these items, basically what happened was that there was concern because the MC Coast and the DNR parcel, which the County Commission recommendation is to acquire both those now, but they're heavily forested. But if you were to do this underlying zoning R9600 designation, you may have a situation where you remove a vast majority of the trees on those properties. And the commission asked the staff to do a little bit of investigation. Okay, what has been happening within our plats within the city? And I've just got a few examples here. Here's a 13-lot subdivision. You can see, of course, where the tree line is and where there's a pretty decent tree canopy there. And this is the resultant development, which you can see that tree canopy is not there anymore. Here's a 32-lot subdivision. Again, not an extensive amount of tree canopy, but still quite a bit. And again, through the subdivision process, it is removed. A 58-lot subdivision, again, through the large amount of canopy, and again, it is removed through the process of the plat. Here's a 68-lot, same thing, a lot of trees removed. And we found quite a few of these. Here's one down in the southern portion of the city, again, where there's a significant amount of tree canopy that is removed in favor of the placement of houses. And of course, the City of Bothell has some planned unit development provisions. And some people say, well, that's kind of where you have this reduction of lot area. We could do some preservation of areas. And while we have had a few planned unit developments, they have not been really sought after by the development community. There's probably a lot of reasons for that. We can get into that a little bit later on. However, one of the aspects of it is that it doesn't necessarily create a lot of open space with that PUD because it has a provision where you only provide the amount of open space that you have for your lot size smaller than. And basically what has happened is that we just have not gotten a lot of areas of open space so far through the PD process. Now, one of the things I want to do is I kind of want to talk a little bit about the background about how the Bothell Municipal Code works for single-family residential areas. And the best way to do that is to do some illustrations. So what staff has done is they've created kind of a test site. And this is about a 5.3-acre site. You can see here there's a stream in one corner and there's a wetland in the other. So you got buffer areas as well as you have, and I decided to put an intact forest area in here just so we get an idea of what is going on with the intact forest areas. This is, of course, also the same one I'm using Fitzgerald, so I'm cheating a little bit, but I'll do whatever I can. And one of the things that we want to identify is that underneath the code, there are certain types of lands that are deducted from your lot area or your dwelling unit yield. And that includes streams and stream buffers, wetlands and wetland buffers, or any type of critical area or critical area buffer. Street right-of-way is also deducted. However, an intact forest area or some heavily treated area is not deducted. So those are the primary provisions that apply. Now, what happens is that you come up with what's called the net buildable area, and that's a real key term for us all to understand. And essentially what is in the blue area, because again, you deduct the street right-of-way, and I've drawn one of those in here, this is the area where you can place lots or dwelling units. Basically, this area in blue is what can be within a single family residential lot or part of a development proposal. So that's the basic net provision. And what happens is that you have a 5.3-acre site. The net buildable area is about 3.8 acres. So that kind of gives you an idea how much land is taken out with those type of features. Now, the Bothell Municipal Code has a very specific mechanism for when it applies for single family. And that is, there is a minimum lot area and a minimum lot circle applied to all of our single family residential zones. And what this illustration does, it just gives you an idea. Up above here, here's the 9600 area. Down below is the R5200D. That's our smallest detached single family residential designation. And I want to point out a couple features here. One, it's not just the area, but it's also this feature called a lot circle. Now, for 9600, that lot circle is 80 feet in diameter. So basically what happens is for every single one of those lots, you have to make sure a circle of 80 feet can fit within that lot. And you have to have 9,600 square feet. And it goes on to even smaller as we go down. Now, one of the things, I put the building coverage up here as well because sometimes people are kind of confused about what building coverage means. Essentially, building coverage as well as hard surface coverage is applied to the individual lot. Basically, what happens is that, and again, this kind of shows the same kind of a mechanism, each lot is allowed to cover 35% of its area with a building. That's the building footprint. Not necessarily, it's not a floor area ratio, it's the footprint. So the, let's say the first floor could be, well, in the case of 9600, 3,300 square feet. You could have a floor on top of that and maybe even another floor on top of that. So the idea is it's not a maximum floor area, it's just the maximum coverage that the lot can have with a building. Now, what this does is that the way the city's Bothell Municipal Code works is that you take that lot area and that lot circle and you apply it to your net buildable area. And essentially what you do is you just basically plot out, here's a 9600 area with an 80-foot circle, and you just put those through the site. And again, I'll mark it in blue so we know it's the same area we're talking about, until you run out of space. That is your lot yield, we'll call it. And in this case, it's 15 lots, which works out to be about 3.8 lots per acre. Same thing with the 8400 zone. You basically fill the site up, whatever you can squeeze in there based upon that lot area and that lot circle. And here you got 17. And again, it's the blue area, which is what is the net buildable area. And that gets about 4.4. Here's 7,200. Same situation. Here's 5,400. Again, same situation. But interestingly enough, you notice how the numbers, of course, increase because the lot area is smaller, so you can fit more lots within the area. Now, there's a bunch of clustering concepts that we decided to come up with to apply to this test site as kind of a way to gauge what kind of clustering concepts may work as we go through this process. And one of it is on the lot yield, and that's an important one because we believe that using the Bothell Municipal Code, and I've given the citation, which is B3, which is basically the calculation method where you take the net buildable area and divide it by the underlying zone. You know, if it's 9,600, you divide it by, you know, you take the square footage and divide it by 9,600, you know, whatever it happens to be. 7,200 be 7,200. That's one way to do this because if we do talk about reducing the lots, it's going to be harder to figure out what that maximum, you know, speed limit would be on the lot yield. The idea is you don't want to have smaller lots and then just fill it up with more smaller lots. You want to have that true open space preservation. Another one to think about is that how much open space do we want to preserve? You know, and that's probably in a range of 15% to 30% of the net build area. Now, within that, there's a whole bunch of options there. We could maybe come up with a way that we could say, well, if you preserve this much open space, you get a little bit more here, and there's a bunch of incentives you could also look at as well. As far as building coverage and hard surface coverage, one of the things that we may have to talk about is we may have to allow some increase in the building coverage, let's say to go from 35% to 45%, and maybe even the hard surface coverage again from 45% to 50% to avoid a potential disincentive. We don't want to have the development community create smaller lots to preserve open space, but then be penalized, if you would, and that may not be a good word, but basically say, well, now I have to have a much smaller house, and that runs into a market issue for them. So we're going to have to come up with some ideas behind that. Side yard setbacks, the same thing. You know, if you have a smaller lot, you can continue to require the standard side yard setbacks. Again, all of a sudden you're making that house really, really narrow in size. One of the areas we also want to talk about is we want to talk about what type of open space we want to preserve. And we can come up with all kinds of different lists. Right now, what the council is talking about is they're talking about intact forests, lands with mature trees, and of course, forest equivalent LID facilities. Those are really specific surface water type facilities. And that's what we're talking about in Fitzgerald. We can apply different standards with citywide. Perhaps there's a need to have a little bit more recreation area, perhaps, and some of those things. So, you know, we're not necessarily limited to these, but we have a lot of leeway for there. And as far as the process to use here, we've been thinking that the planned unit development process, which is in place, it's pretty well accepted. It's been around for many, many years, is probably the best process to use when we evaluate clustering provisions. It's in place. It's got more flexibility. We can do some different things. And it also would give the applicant a way to be able to have a predictable process as well as the community as a whole, because everybody is pretty familiar with the PUD process. So what I did is that we have got some potential scenarios here. What would happen if we applied those kind of items? You know, a 50% lot reduction and a 50% lot circle reduction, as well as using the yield calculation of B3, which is basically just take the net build well and divide it by 9,600 or whatever the underlying zoning happens to be. And in this case, a 9,600, we get 17 lots because you don't have that inefficiency, if you would, of the lot laying out that way. And that provides quite a substantial amount of potential open space there. Now, this is, again, a kind of an extreme example because I'm taking as much flexibility as possible. You know, some of the lots would probably be a little bit larger. I tried to stay in a 4,800 to 5,000 square foot area. But that gives you kind of an idea of what could potentially happen. One of the interesting things is I ran some numbers on, let's say we did go with this 45% building cover within this area, and it is still less than what would happen if we had a non-clustering area, because again, it depends based upon the lot area. If your lots are smaller, your coverage is smaller, even if you have a greater percentage that's allowed to be counted. 8,400, same thing. We've got a large area of open space that is potentially capable of being provided. We go to 19 lots instead of the 17. 1,700, we bumped up to 23 lots. Again, a very large amount of open space in comparison to what we would get if we did not have clustering. 5100 was D is an interesting one because it is such a smaller scaled lot anyway. And there's only so small you can make the lot. You know, I mean, 3,000 square feet seems to be what we're seeing most of the market build. You know, a lot of 3,500s and stuff like that. But that seems to be kind of the smallest one. And that's basically what we did here. It's not quite as dramatic of open space savings as some of the larger lot zoning provision would be, but it's still substantial.
Hey, Bruce.
Yes.
Can you go back to that slide?
Yes, you bet.
How wide are those lots on the
5400? I made them 30-foot circles.
30-foot?
Yeah, so that's really small.
Thank you.
You bet. And again, I thought we'd just come back to the MC Coast property, and this was kind of what started this whole genesis here. Because we did a little scenario, okay, what would happen if we did develop this as just a straight single-family standard plat, which was the idea that the commission identified, boy, that's not so sure we want to do this. And essentially what it does is it fills up the property with lots and roads and things of that nature. But if we were to apply clustering, you may be able to, again, preserve quite a bit of open space. And so this was kind of the genesis. I did this just kind of as something to kind of bring us back to where we were, get our to our roots. Now, there's quite a few features that we may want to explore while we do this discussion. And one is that maybe there's a type of development we want clustering to apply to. Maybe it's only detached single-family areas we apply to. Maybe we allow attached dwelling units. Now, that would be a way to really get some serious open space, but it's a market thing. I mean, that'd be something we'd have to get some more input on. Or allow massive amount of flexibility and allow the developer to make his selection as to what he would like to do. That's just a possibility. Or we could say, look, you got to build what the zoning code allows, detached single family, multifamily, whatever it happens to be. One of the things that we have, of course, I can't remember how many of you remember this one, but we had this thing called a fee simple lot, which is an offspring lot, parent lot offspring thing. And there's a lot more detached single family being done with common wall construction. That might be something we may want to look at as well, because that may be, again, a way to really compact the development footprint, if you would, of that project. Again, that's something that we have to have a little bit more discussion with the market, because they may say, look, that's just not really likely we want to do it. Another item that we will have to talk about is maybe some incentives to encourage clustering. I know this is something that we've kind of talked a little bit about in many, many years past, but it's never really gelled very well. But we have received testimony from the building industry and the development community about, you know, some type of incentive, because what they're looking at is they're looking at maybe if we can have a couple more units, I don't know, whatever the number is, or maybe a little bit more height for multifamily, then the clustering kind of pencils out for them. And so that's one of the things that I think we should be willing to look at. And that basically be what we call bonus densities. That's not a good term, but basically what it'd be allowing a little few, I don't know what the number is, but some type of a thing. And maybe you tie the bonus densities to the amount of open space they preserve. If they preserve 10%, okay, you get 5%. You preserve 15%, you get 10. You just kind of do that kind of a sliding scale to really encourage that type of a development activity. So those are all the things we can begin to look at. There's a wide range of possibilities, including doing some next steps. One of the things I would like to do is I'd like to do a little more investigation of what some of the surrounding jurisdictions do. I've done some of that, but other jurisdictions have got really different approaches than the city of Bothell. The city of Bothell is kind of unusual in the fact that we've got this very rigid lot area, lot circle that's applied. Most communities say, okay, in your, well, they usually don't have a 9600, it's usually an R4 or an R6. And they say within that you have four units per acre, you divide it by, many of them divide it by the gross area, not even a net area. You divide that, that's the number, and then every lot has to be at least 3,000 square feet or 4,000 square feet. That is the more common method most jurisdictions do. However, I want to take a little bit look and see if there's some other provisions there are. I do know for sure that there are jurisdictions that provide bonus densities for certain types of features. Snohomish County is a real classic case. King County does the same thing. Our Our fellow communities on either side of us also have some bonus provisions they allow for certain types of elements that are added to the project. A lot of times it's a park or something like that. So I want to do a little bit of research on that one. We want to get some more feedback from the development community. In fact, one of the things I'll be doing here in the next couple of weeks, I'll be saying, okay, we've started this process. We've had a little bit of discussion with the commission, and we'd like to get your feedback. But we also want to get some feedback from residents, and hopefully we can get some folks to come and say, hey, you know, I live next to a house that has, I'm not sure what it is, and I think that I have a concern about a lot of this saved or something like that. We want to look at that as well because, you know, that's going to be one of those trade-off things. Okay, well, yeah, we can keep a lot of about the same size as you have, but that means more trees are going to be removed. So it's that, what are we going to do here? What's going to be the best thing in the for the community? Identify some other approaches. I'm not sure what those are going to be yet, but I'm still thinking about that. And the other one that's kind of an interesting aspect that I haven't really seen very much is that you really don't see much for multifamily clustering. You just don't see that applied very often because multifamily is already a pretty flexible zone. And usually what you do with a multifamily is you give them greater height. And that is always kind of an issue because suddenly you have greater height and if they have some more staff there. I do not know if there is a really successful multifamily clustering provision out there, but I'm going to try and see if I can find that.
Hey, Bruce. So
yes.
That whole idea of increasing height, that
yes.
kind of intrigues me a little bit. Do you see a lot of that? I mean, other than two-story with a daylight basement, do you see any single-family three-story stuff?
Very okay. rarely. Very rarely. It's usually two-story okay. with a daylight. Yeah.
Gotcha.
Two and a half stories.
Okay. Is that because of the code, because of the height restrictions?
It's mostly the code and the height restrictions. Most of our single-family areas are 30-foot height.
Right.
So it's really tough to get that third story within that 30 feet unless you do some really flat roof.
Yeah, I think it'd be interesting to see maybe from the building community if they think that. Because to me, it seems like if we're trying to condense our development, going up is one way to do that, you know, and to minimize the footprint. But I don't know, market-wise, I don't. You know, I've seen them in various places, but
yeah, you know, we've got a pretty good
example. Standard.
We got a pretty good example of that. The Collage, which is just north of the Delanda Dog Inn on the Bothell Everett Highway, that's on the west side. Mm-hmm. That's a fairly tall, kind of townhouse type development, and they have a really large area of open space they preserve now. Mostly that was because it was mandatory; it was a curricular area, so they had to do that, but they kind of compensated that. I guess they figured out, okay, with this number of lots we had to, or this many of units, we had to have a certain square footage. So they went up. And, you know, it's kind of an interesting concept to kind of look at.
David. Quick question, Bruce.
Yes.
Thanks for putting this together. This is a great amount of information. Before I get into the details, I just want to know procedurally. I was looking ahead at our schedule. Looks like we only look at clustering one more time, and then we're having a public hearing on clustering as it relates to Nike Hill, or is that? No, I guess that's the council. Never mind.
That's the council, yes.
So we're going to see this multiple times before we come to any decisions.
We know we're not going to have this finished by the end of this year, and we just have to admit that that's not a possibility. And in this case, I think it's a good idea because we want to take some time and really get look into this pretty quick because this could be a really important feature for the community. So, yeah, but yeah, you get it one more time this year or two more times.
At some point, I have a couple questions going around when I was doing my own little homework on there. So a little knowledge is a dangerous thing.
That's always a good thing, actually.
So one thing I'm interested in is zero lot line.
Yes.
So I understand we could do a shared wall.
Yes, we could.
Could we also stagger them where a building sits on a zero lot line on one side and has its setback shared with its neighbor who's sitting on their zero lot line?
Yeah, there's.
What does that look like, and is that a good way to increase floor space?
It's a good way to have a really efficient layout. And basically what happens is kind of sometimes you call those Z lots. Well, they have this little thing, and then you have, okay, well, I have a really blank wall on my side. That's where my neighbor has his yard. But my over here where I have my windows, I have a nice, and my neighbor has that. those are kind of Z lots. Those are a pretty effective way to have that clustering provision close in.
Where so you could get more in.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
Well, and I don't want to say more in, because we want to come up with a way that we get approximately about the number, unless we decide to do some type of bonus. But the concept would be, yes, those type of different development styles would be something that we'd want to take a look at.
Okay, and then another idea that intrigues me, and I'm thinking of it as a term coming at a contour of land perspective. If you've got a big area of land to begin with, that it will become less incidental for its neighboring properties. And also deal with parking problems and still allow for your open spaces. If there's basement parking in these smaller upzoned areas, do you know what I'm talking about? So where the height is going up and you've got the parking underneath the building. And I don't know if a developer would look at that and go, that doesn't pencil out. But it seems to me that if you could put parking underneath a building, you know, single family homes, duplexes, that you could go up as long as it's not intrude. The open space is that buffer with its neighbors.
Yeah, in fact, actually, I think a lot of the development community calls that a tuck under, where you actually have the garage that's underneath the, you know, and that's where you get to that 2.5 story. That's a tuck under. They go underneath there, and then they have the living areas above. Those are all things that could be considered.
And would you put those considerations in a talking about bonuses and or?
Well, and one of our objectives is to have a smaller development footprint. And we don't want to get too dictatorial to the development community. We want to say, look, if you achieve this, whatever form that happens to take, we should be acceptable.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Bruce. That was great. Okay. I love these diagrams you put together. They're really well done. Just three quick questions. You were talking at the very beginning about the fact that over in the Fitzgerald area, they're doing a clustering thing that's mostly related to kind of the Nick Fuchapa area. Is that correct?
Yes.
You said these are kind of, they almost seem like they're competing clustering ordinances, but how would that work within that area? If we did a clustering ordinance as part of what we're talking about now, would that augment or replace, or would it not apply in the Fitzgerald area?
Initially it would not apply. Okay. Essentially what would happen is that the Fitzgerald code and plan amendments have to be done by the end of this year. We know that the clustering is probably going to go a little bit into 2017. And so what we're going to have a specialized clustering provision within that sub area. Now, once we complete this process, we may at that time just say, well, you know, this is such a better product, we want to replace the one in Fitzgerald with this, whatever the citywide is. So there's a lot of things to go over there from that standpoint. Again, though, the focus of the Fitzgerald is kind of an environmental, you know, certain types of, you know, low impact development, bioinfiltration, forest retention, and stuff like that. It's got a little bit different focus, but not tremendously different.
And in that Fitzgerald sub area, is that clustering that they're working on there only applicable in the Nick Fuchapa portion of that area, or will it be area wide?
It would probably be just within, well, there's two areas that would be applicable. Within the Nick Fuchapa, there's already some clustering allowed. There's allowed for a 50% reduction in the lot area. Within the what they call the hillside area, which is east of 39th Avenue, the proposal right now is to look at removing that from the Nick Fuchapa and applying a special clustering provision there. And that's kind of where most of the emphasis is being placed right now, is to companion that with a bunch of other protections.
Okay, thank you. Second, you mentioned the possibility of multifamily clustering. That would be really neat to see if you could figure it out, to see some examples like you've put together, or some diagrams, some actual layouts that would kind of illustrate that as well, because I've always kind of thought of, for example, the 5400A being possibly for doing attached product is almost by definition its own clustering mechanism. You know, if you have the option of doing it detached or attached, if you do it attached, then You know, you're not technically getting necessarily getting any more density, but you are able to put those units into the area of the site that works best for you. And so it'd be interesting to see how you would add a clustering component onto that when it's already seems to be multifamily seems to be a kind of a clustering.
Yeah, and I think that's the challenge because as I've been looking at this, okay, and I've been kind of doing a little bit of searching, okay, what is there out there for multifamily? And most of the time it is taller building,
mm-hmm.
and then you, okay, well, instead of taking up half the site, you take up 30% of the site, and then you leave it in some type of an open space tract, but you get a much taller building. And that has some other ancillary impacts that we have to think about as well. Which is
well, it has some ancillary benefits, too, because it seems to me that you go taller, you're not increasing your impervious surface. You're stacking one impervious surface on top of another, so it there's actually a benefit there in a lot of ways. So, I mean, sure there's pluses and minuses. Last thing I want to ask you about, this whole concept of the lot circle diameter is interesting to me. I'm curious, I know a little bit about how it was arrived at in the city, but there aren't many cities that have that sort of thing. If they do, it's much, much smaller. The way the city of Bothell is set up is it's a pretty big diameter for the corresponding zoning. What is the benefit of increasing the lot circle diameter? Do you have any opinion on that or thoughts?
I think the approach then was to have a certain style of single family house, which is basically okay, relatively wide, a pretty good sized community type in the 9600 as well as some of the other zones. And I think it was basically a response to some of the really small lots that people were seeing around the area and saying, look, that's just too small. We just don't feel that's appropriate for Bothell. I think that the discussion now is around the same, okay, maybe that was a great approach then, but maybe we've got a new look at this area. Maybe we should do a little bit more for as far as the preservation of trees and things like that. And I think that's partly from the examples we have here, because there is nothing that opens your eyes more than seeing a place go from this to this. I mean, that has had a real impact on the community is how that is mm-hmm. occurring. Mm-hmm. And I think that has been a real genesis for how we want to look at this.
Yeah. I mentioned that it was done due to concern about smaller lot sizes, but it seems to me that that's the intent of zoning is to one big intent of zoning is to create minimum lot sizes in a zone, and that takes care of that. And then it's never really made sense to me why putting a lot circle diameter on top of that. I mean, it seems to be trying to do the same thing, but it more has the impact of just creating a certain geometry on a lot as opposed to a lot size, and that may not really necessarily mean that geometry is any better than any other geometry. It seems it just has always seemed
and I think you've hit it really well. It was a geometry thing. It wasn't just the size of the lot, because in theory you could have a 40-foot wide lot going back 180 feet. We wanted to have a width thing and a presence thing. So,
but what was that?
It was an aesthetic kind of an approach as well.
So it was an aesthetic thing to a certain extent?
I think there was some aesthetics involved, absolutely, yes.
Interesting. Okay. Thank you.
It's been a long time since we did that.
Yeah.
Right. Oh. Completely. Bruce, thank you for this information. It's it's good to finally get to this point where, you know, where we're talking about the clustering, because I know that we started this conversation, I think, in 2014. So
almost.
Yeah. I don't understand the PUD process and why that hasn't been used primarily by a lot of developers. And actually, I think at one or two meetings we did hear some feedback from a couple of residents saying, you know, we already have something in place, the PUD, so let's use that. So could you kind of expound upon what it is and why it's not being implemented by the development community?
Yeah, and I think that what you can look at is that, let's say if you had this property and you think, well, maybe I'll do a PUD and reduce my lot areas and maybe I can get a couple more lots. That's not the case. You still have to do this, what we call a mock plat. that basically does this exercise, the lot-by-lot application of the area and the lot circles. And that number 15 is how many lots you get. The PUD is an additional process that you have to go through and requires more analysis, more documentation, and some other provisions that you have to go before the hearing examiner. It's a type 3, you know, public hearing process. What the development community has identified in a lot of these cases is that if I'm going to do just a regular straight plat layout anyway, and that's how many lots I'm going to get, I'm going to do that because that seems to be the market that they're looking for. Why would I go through the additional expenses and time and effort to do a product that gets me the same number? And so that has always been an issue with the development community. Another aspect is that our standard PUD has a pretty small amount of lot area reduction. I mean, we're talking about a 15% lot area reduction or a 10% lot circle reduction. So if you're in an I-600 zone, you're going from an 80-foot circle to a 72-foot circle. Is that enough to go through that additional expense of doing the PUD? It may not. And our experience has been that there really have not been very many PUDs processed through the city.
Thank you. That's helpful.
Commissioner Cecil.
Thank you, Bruce. Quite a packet. A lot of colors and layouts.
I like colors.
That's a lot of time, I know. I guess back to that lot circle thing, in my engineering time and when I have done some projects in Bothell, what I've found is that there's a minimum frontage requirement on a lot, which is typically much less than what the lot circle is. And so my frustration has been in the past that because you want to narrow something because you have to get it fit in order to get the lot circle in there, you got to shove the lot circle to the back. And then on the next lot over, then you got to shove the lot circle to the front because, you know, and so you end up with these lots that are kind of this really weird, like Argyle or something. It's just kind of, so that's, anyway, that's kind of editorial. But I also am interested with the PUD history. From what you just explained, I don't know why, not only do I not know why anybody would do a PUD, but I don't know why the city would have that provision. It doesn't seem like anybody would do that. Is there any benefit to a developer of doing something like that?
Well,
other than saving the forest, and I understand that too,
right,
but
right.
Most developers are, you know, there's a bottom line and there's other things that you gotta, benchmarks you gotta hit.
Well, if you're just doing a hard, cold logic of, okay, what's the bottom line difference? There's not much difference. There might be a little bit of savings because, you know, instead of 80 feet, it's 72 feet, so you get a little bit less roadway frontage. I don't think it usually pencils out for most of the developers. In fact, we had one development in the southern portion of the city where the developer actually came to the city and said, folks, I have a choice. I can either build a straight plat or I can do something much more innovative by having a much compressed footprint, but you got to let me have a much smaller lot. And the answer was, no, I'm sorry. We believe this lot area is the most important thing that we can do for the character of the community. And he was sent away, and subsequently he developed a regular standard plat that took out a significant portion of some nice forested areas.
So I guess for me it would be good to know when that PUD provision was put into place. Has it always been there, or?
It was changed in 1996.
Okay, and then so on, I guess on the tails of that, how many PUDs have there been that use that provision?
I can look up that count, but
it would be really good to know.
It's a very small.
Because we're trying to figure out how big of an issue this is as well, right? And so I think that'd be really good to know for us if the current code is just doesn't make sense and people aren't using it, then that's a baseline for us, right? And we can kind of figure out some of the things we can improve on it, I think. So.
Yep.
Let's see. I guess I wanted to clarify. So, you know, in these layouts, there's, you know, it might show some sensitive areas or wetlands or, you know, steep slopes or whatever. To clarify, none of the critical areas of their buffers are, they're all out of bounds. In other words, they're not part of the additional open space. I mean, they might be contiguous, but that's you don't get credit for that. That you'd have to do that anyway.
Exactly.
Correct?
Yes. Okay. Exactly. And that's why I spent so much time on the net buildable area, because yeah. that's where you're going to have the lot development occur. And if we can take an approach that preserves lands within that area, then we are accomplishing something that's over and above what our usual provisions are.
Okay. A couple more.
Commissioner Cecil, I think there are jurisdictions that actually do allow you to use those areas in your calculation, but I'm not sure that it really makes sense if our goal is to try to increase the amount of open space. It doesn't seem like it would achieve that. It would just be almost given a free benefit away at, you know, I think getting the additional open space is mm-hmm. seems to me to be really important. So.
And so when we talk about open space too, I'm real curious to see how that's going to flesh out. And I know you're going to do some research. And so if we can give you some specifics when you're doing research of what other cities are doing, I'm very curious as to are there kind of minimum dimensional requirements for the open space? In other words, can a guy just, you know, do open space all around the edge? Or does it need to be, you know, like I think in Redmond, it's got to be 15 feet minimum dimension, something like that. So there's some criteria that it has to meet. It's got to be, you know, contiguous. And I'd really like to see some of that. So, you know, as a commission, we can, you know, kind of have a visual of what we're asking for, right?
Right. In fact, that's one of the things that I've been trying to identify, what would be a logical area.
Yeah.
And I'll just throw this off the top of my head because you guys can think about this. The minimum buffer for any type of critical area is 25 feet. That seems like that's kind of a reasonable minimal dimension, but I haven't gone much into the analysis mm-hmm. of that. But it seems to be maybe 25 feet is the minimum width we want to look at.
Yeah. Another thing, too, I think would be really could be beneficial in certain areas. If you have an area of the city where you've got some really good open space corridors already, or maybe you've got a park or something like that, it seems like your criteria for open space for this should include something that says if there's a public forest next to you or a already dedicated open space next to you on your east property line, we would prefer the open space to be contiguous with that, because I think we're not trying to get a bunch of little pockets. I think we're trying to really save some, you know, big areas if we can, as big as possible.
Yeah, and you're exactly right. We're going to want to have some locational criteria there. That says, okay, it makes no sense, as you identified. Hey, I've got this big open space I'm going to stay over here, but my development is separating that from another big open space. We're going to have to come up with some of those provisions.
Yeah. And then I guess in your research as well, and maybe you already know this from our PUD ordinance, but who's going to own the open space and what can be done in the open space? In other words, it seems like if it's not a critical area, we should be able to passively recreate in it, you know, enjoy it. But is it owned by your neighborhood? Is it owned by the city? Is it accessible by other people? That kind of thing. So.
Right. Most of the time, in fact, the vast majority of time, the city prefers it to be a common ownership between everybody within that individual subdivision. Mm-hmm. And even from our experience, that has worked really well, because the best eyes and ears we have are the people who live in that neighborhood, who become very protective of those open space areas. So that usually works the best way to get, as far as that, you know, as far as the ownership goes.
I'm done. That's all I have. Thank you.
Just kind of as a tail on to that also, I would think from a liability standpoint, we would not want the city to own a lot of those individual open spaces.
And that's correct, too.
Yeah.
Commissioner Hampton?
Yeah, so thanks for this, Bruce. This is really helpful. The fellow commissioners asked a lot of the questions I already had here, but I wanted to pile on Commissioner Cecil's about the ownership of this land. So the King County assessor, the Snohomish County assessor, what it says, property values based on lot square footage and then the built environment on that lot. So how would this affect our property tax collections if this is kind of a shared ownership? It would be more difficult for the assessor to assess the value of each property?
Well, actually, what happens is that it's held in undivided interest. There's usually a tract established. And so the assessor assesses the individual houses based upon their valuation. And the open space is usually not taxed. Basically, it's covered by the taxation of the houses themselves. And one of the things that would be interesting about this is that we'd actually be kind of transferring density, if you would. That, I know it's kind of a broad, but from those opens, what become open space to the rest of the development. So it is kind of interesting. I think that the assessor would say, no, we consider that an open space. It's not taxed as a viable piece of property from a development standpoint.
So we're potentially losing tax revenue by doing something like this?
No, not at all, not at all. Basically, what the idea behind it is that you would still have the houses that would be assessed, and they would be part of that overall development. And that's what the assessor will basically apply there. The open space that's created is basically, you know, the value has been transferred to those houses. Let's say you have a house that's against one of these big open space areas. Well, that has a value that the assessor tries to assign them. So those things usually get picked up somehow.
So we could probably look at an example of two developments that have similar size developments, and one has a critical area, so there is an open space already, and maybe has a smaller lot size, and we could see if those houses, if they're comparable, if the land is assessed at the same rate. Is that something we could find?
Yeah, we can do that.
Okay, thank you. And then
you bet.
The other question I had, and you touched on it a little bit with building coverage.
Yes.
We'd also have to review or revisit the hard surface coverage, right?
We certainly will, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I didn't put it in my presentation because I didn't want to get too many numbers thrown out there, but
okay.
That would absolutely have to be one of the elements that would have to be looked at as we look at making the lots much smaller.
So I assume we'll have some tables or something next time to look at with that. Perfect. All right,
thank you.
Okay, I have a few comments, and then obviously anybody else, everybody's going to think about other things they wanted to ask, so feel free to jump in a little bit. First, yeah, thanks a lot, Bruce, for this presentation. Not only was the packet excellent, the examples that you brought and kind of brought to light a lot of what we maybe could have saved with the type of clustering mechanism, it's pretty stark. So thanks for presenting us with those that weren't in the packet. Those are really good to see. I really appreciate that. Commissioner Hampton said, a lot of the other commissioners have brought up a lot of things I already had to say. So thanks everybody for all the good questions you've had so far. It was good to get guidance here on page 13 from what the council said that wanted to be their priorities, I guess, with regards to, and Commissioner Cecil was touching on it earlier, and I was kind of right in line with what they're saying. It kind of gives us a prioritization of what we want to try to work into this with regards to the mechanism we set up, how to prioritize in there these particular things, and just so that maybe a developer can't just kind of put a little bit here, a little bit here. I mean, that we want them to kind of maybe coincide with critical areas and a forested area that's already there, so it can be continuous. One thing when we're talking about like bonuses or incentives to give out to the development community, maybe affordable housing is something we can work into that too. I don't know. I don't know how that would look, but it's just something I guess I would. I don't know if you can, when you look at other jurisdictions, if there's anything about affordable housing that they can kind of bring into it, maybe having an additional lot or two, if it's in the affordable range, maybe that's something we want to look at. Another question I might have is there any plat size that would be too small for a clustering mechanism? I mean, I don't know, but it's just, I'm just thinking about things that maybe we can think about. I think that It is an interesting point that Commissioner Hampton made about the taxation. I think we're going to find that a lot of, and maybe you'll be able to tell us this when you bring back examples, I think you're going to find that a lot of communities, a lot of people who are purchasing homes will see this as a huge benefit to have an area that's an open space. So, I mean, if they have children, they don't have to maybe drive them to the park or drive them to a sports field, or they can just come go have somewhere to play. People of all ages, I guess. And with regards to these, are I guess things I'm thinking about when we see what other jurisdictions are doing. So when we have this open space that we, you know, that we're preserving, so when a developer goes in there and is setting aside, say, 30% of the developable area, what is the developer allowed to do with that area while under construction? I mean, could that be part of the development process? I think it'd be kind of interesting if maybe, you know, with the grading of the soil, that they could potentially put that graded, you know, the soil they're removing, put it on the area they're going to preserve, and yet at the end put it back. Because I know we were talking about possibly soil retention, and so would the developer be able to put it on that area? I think that would seem reasonable within. I mean, it wouldn't be the natural state, but it seems to make sense to keep the soil on site and redistribute it. Also, like trees, if trees were to be removed, would they be able to put them in the open space? If it was a forested area, I personally wouldn't see a huge issue with maybe some larger trees or whatever, you know, the logs or whatever put back in there if the development community does, if it saves them some money. I don't know, you know, I was thinking of ways to keep the natural environment on site. And so those are things to think about. Maybe that's overcomplicating it. Maybe you need to take the soil off site, take the trees off site. I don't know.
Yeah, and it kind of depends on what your objective there is. If you want to preserve we'll use hydrogeology. Basically, the idea is you want to preserve that piece of land's ability to take surface water runoff into it. You don't put soil on top of it. You have to kind of leave it alone. If you're creating a recreational area, okay, we can kind of regrade this and make this into a better ball field or a tennis court or something like that. So that's going to be one of the things that we're going to have to wind in. Okay, what is the purpose here? And if it's acceptable to accept recreation space, what you've identified as could occur, well, maybe they do regrade it to make it more usable from that standpoint. So that'll be one of the things we'll have a discussion about. I know that in Fitzgerald, the emphasis is about preserving existing forested area. That's the real fundamental aspect that we're trying to apply there. Mm-hmm. But this is a little bit different. This is citywide, and I think we do have some ability to do something that's a little bit different from the Fitzgerald area.
Great. Commissioner Cecil.
I just listening to your comments, it's kind of got me thinking about, you know, what is open space, and I've been doing parks for a lot of years, and I still don't know exactly what definition of open space is, but maybe when you're doing your research as well, Bruce, you can look and see if other jurisdictions are, I mean, this is a really good kind of priority list here that's on that page that Dave was just talking about. But what if there's someone who has 5 acres and it's pretty much pasture? Do we still want to encourage open space? I live on a hill right across from the collage on the other side of the valley, and that whole hill it's a big, huge bowl behind the apartments, probably 10 acres of woods back there around the edge. And we have a neighborhood barbecue every year, and Julia, who's kind of our matriarch, who's been there forever, always tells us, you know, about the history of the hillside, and there's huge trees on that hill, you know. And she was telling us a couple years ago, she says, yeah, back in the 50s, she said, I could see Yakima Fruit Market from here. I said, what? This is like, what are you talking about? She goes, yeah, there was no trees on this hill, you know. And so I guess just thinking about, could we make open space where we are planting trees, right? It might not be a forest right now, but, you know, we're planning for long term here. We're not, you know, we're not trying to get our bang for the buck in 10 years, you know. And so I think that something like that where if you had some incentive for them to do some tree plantings or whatever, I think it's worth looking into, especially with the long term. So interesting thought, though. I mean, I always am thinking, okay, big trees, forest, open space, yeah, put it aside, protect it. And but if you've got areas that are, you know, maybe they aren't that beautiful right now, but maybe they could be down the road. So anyway.
Excellent points. Oh, Commissioner Cape.
Two quick questions. Page 13 of the packet, you laid out four different options for how we could look at laying out some of these lots. The second option was eliminate all lot area and circle minimums. In other words, the size and dimensions of the lots would be left to the discretion of the developer and builder and the market. I'm not as concerned with minimums, but maybe I'm missing the point. Would the hesitation in doing option two, would that be an odd or skinny shaped lot, or is that more keeping it in kind with the neighboring community?
Well, interestingly enough, that is an aspect that we've been debating about what we should do there. And here's an example. Here's the 9600 clustering, and we're taking it down a 50% reduction. But what if there were no minimums at all? May say, look, you build what you want to build. We just want to have the open space. And that is a, you know, it's kind of a large leap of faith, honestly. But that is certainly a possibility. And one of the things that a lot of jurisdictions do in their single family areas is say, look, our minimum lot size is 2,500 square feet. I know a jurisdiction that has 2,500 square foot lot, no myth or anything. They just let you do what the market will bear. And that's an approach that the city has not taken so far.
Yeah, and it sounds extreme. I'm thinking that we're not adding density, and there'll be some equilibrium point where it won't make sense for them to go to 2,800 square foot lots when they had 9,600 from a marketability standpoint. But I was just kind of curious on that issue. If we do allow changing from detached zoning to attached, would there be any modifications to the bordering properties? My only concern was either like a landscape buffer or, because we are preserving open space, there will be green spaces, but it doesn't necessarily mean that it's adjacent to the neighborhood that's already well established. I think the one example that we've looked at as a success is it Canyon Ridge Condos near the Nike Hill development, and that's sort of on an island by itself, so I don't think it really faced the issues that we might see throughout the city here.
Actually, that's a good point, because there's quite a few provisions within the code that when you have a certain height, in fact, more in some areas in the city, the single family is allowed to go up to 35 feet, but there's a couple provisos, and one of those is you got to be farther from the property line. So those are all things that we can start implementing here. And I think that one of the advantages of using the PUD is there is a couple of built-in buffer provisions in the PUD. One of those is I shouldn't say buffer, setbacks. The front yard setback applies to the entire perimeter of the PUD, and that's a single family would be 20 feet. So the idea is that instead of the 15 or 5 foot, if it's a side yard, that would be around a PUD, you have to have a 20-foot setback. That gives you a little bit more dimension there. So that's something that we can enhance if we so desire, and depend upon how much area you do. And I think you're correct. If you went with an attached unit, you would want to have a pretty substantial buffer there.
Okay. And I'm in agreement that we need some sort of encouragement for the development community to use the clustering ordinance. Since the green PUD and regular PUD is in effect and we're not really getting any traction, I guess my question's tagged on to Commissioner Vliet's as far as a minimum, minimum development size that clustering would make sense. Would we also have a minimum, offsetting benefit? It seems like, when we're talking about 5%, you might have a small development that does preserve some open space, but they'd have a fractional lot. It seems like at a minimum, they would have a lot or something to come out of it. But that's just when we get into that a little bit more. It seems like that section specifically, it might be some difficult code language, and we want to keep it as straightforward as possible, but that was just one thing I was thinking about.
Yeah, I do have a question after Commissioner Cecil and Vliet spoke about the type of open space that would be preserved. And I agree with Commissioner Cecil, but I'm curious, the future use of these open spaces be? And I heard you say, Bruce, something about a tennis court or a play field or something. Would that be a consideration to allow that type of use?
I think it could be, yes. I think that, and again, depending upon what you're looking at. Now, I know that primarily what has been the genesis on this is preserving the existing area we have. And that may be what ends up being the result of here. Look, tennis courts are great, but there's a school, or, you know, soccer fields are great, but there's a ball field over there. We want to just preserve open space and trees, and that would be that's okay. So, yeah, I think the idea is that as we start narrowing this down and identifying what types of open space that are suitable, we'll have some of those discussions.
And is that a list that you think you'll come with, or some options, or we'll discuss?
Long list. I'm sorry.
You don't have to. I would steer away from, you know, creating park space for active use and creating more conservation areas within the city. I think like you said, the genesis of this, and I think that that's how I always envisioned, you know, how this would work and why it would work. But I would agree with Commissioner Cecil that we should allow for some restoration, but that opens the door for who's going to manage that restoration, because it's not a simple process. You don't just plant some alders and maples and hope for the best. You know, it takes some stewardship, and if the city's not taking ownership of that, you can't make the residents take ownership of that. So something to think about.
Commissioner Clark.
Thank you. As I'm sitting here listening to the fellow commissioners talk, it brings up a lot of questions and ideas and a lot of good ideas out there. I think Commissioner Cave, you bring up a great point about should there be a minimum size, and would they benefit if they did do clustering? I think it's important to at least look at how do we try to include them so that there is an incentive for these smaller properties to do clustering and to preserve vegetation as well, because frankly there are a lot of small properties in Bothell, and I think we can get a lot of bang for the buck out of those. And I think that if you've got a 2-acre parcel over here and a 2-acre parcel over here, having them both preserve 30% of their vegetation or something is huge, because the alternative is that you might have an entire street that doesn't have any preserved vegetation on it. So I think as we go through this, we should look at how do we incentivize those smaller projects, even if there's a density percentage bonus, if that can't apply to them, what do we do to make it more attractive for them to do that? I think that's really important. Maybe active open space in those areas is one of them. Maybe there's a certain minimum they get. I don't know. You guys will figure it out, but I think that is important. The other thing I want to mention, a couple specifics. I really like the idea of kind of having a graduated incentive that is relative to the amount of open space you set aside. I think that really maximizes the incentive, actually. It allows developers to really be creative with how they set open space aside. And if they know that, hey, if I put another 10,000 square feet aside, I get that bumps me up to the next category that gives me an additional lot or whatever that is, I think that's really important to try to maximize the benefit of this. Because I think if you don't, there's going to be a point where somebody's going to say, okay, we've done everything we can to get to this level. There's no point in doing anything else, you know. And I think that could be a real valuable thing. I think it's also important that if we're going to look at, you know, modifying dimensional standards and requirements on individual lots, such as lot circle diameter and setbacks, whatever those kinds of things are, I think we also need to look at it on a project-wide basis. For example, right-of-way widths or cul-de-sac diameters or something like that, because there's kind of another really big benefit of that, which is, you know, we've talked a lot about LID, low-impact development, and that sort of thing as we've gone through this last review of the NPDES. That is a direct way to limit impervious surface if we can add an incentive and allow them to shrink the right-of-way somehow. Obviously, there are certain standards you have to adhere to, but we should look at how flexible we can be on that. And, you know, maybe we can cut the public road surface on a project by 15-20%. Well, that's 15-20% of the impervious surface that's gone. It's also 15% of the total area that does never has to be maintained. It never has to be repaved. It never has to have a new sidewalk, all that kind of stuff. So I think there's potentially a big benefit of that as well. I'm just kind of working my way through a couple things here. I also wonder, on the same topic of LID, low impact development, these open space areas that we might be setting up, could they not only be used for passive recreation, but is there a possibility from a biology standpoint or an engineering standpoint, they could be used as areas for groundwater recharge, stormwater, putting stormwater into these features? Maybe that limits the amount of kind of more unnatural detention that we have to do, detention vaults and that kind of thing. If we can utilize, as we know, one of the biggest LID tools that we have is infiltration. And if you have an area that you can not only infiltrate stormwater, but filter stormwater, grass and forest duff and that sort of thing, and trees, frankly, are one of the greatest ways to filter stormwater. Trees suck up a lot of water. Duff and grass filters water, takes sediment and other, you know, harmful things out of it. So, you know, we should keep our minds open to doing something that would allow us to, again, really leverage the value of these areas without damaging them. You know, we're putting water back into them that is valuable. I noticed on pages 14 through 18 of this, your examples, I think another thing that might really make a difference and might be very palatable to neighbors of these properties is, we're setting aside these open spaces, and I'm not criticizing your layouts here. I'm just suggesting that if you look at, say, for example, page 15, figure 19 with the R9600 clustering, if we could find a way to put some of that native growth or that preserved open space, if that could be on the property line, whether it's existing forest or a buffer that we could plant, like Roger's suggesting, for the future, you're creating a buffer between what would be kind of a more intense use in a lot of ways. It's clustered, they're smaller lots, they're closer together. And, you know, if you're the guy that's up on the upper left, the neighbor on the upper left-hand corner or the north side of this thing that has 200 feet of forest between you and this neighborhood, you're going to care less than the guy that's on the south side that his lot borders up against, instead of bordering up against one or two lots, he might be bordering up against four lots. If we could find a way to, like you talked about, a buffer, but also utilize trees if we can in those areas to make it an even better buffer, not just space but actual mass to fill that area, I think that would be worthwhile. That might make it more palatable for the people that would otherwise, you know, maybe be opposed to a project that was adjacent to them. I think the bottom line is, if you're going and developing a piece of property in an existing neighborhood, it's the existing neighbors that we should be concerned about and the impact on them. And not so much the people that are buying the new homes in the neighborhood. They're purchasing those homes with the full knowledge that this is what I'm getting, and I know I'm going to have a neighbor right next to me. So they're making that purchasing decision and have a choice about it. So I feel like that's an important aspect. And then on page 13, I think it was maybe it was Commissioner Cabe that mentioned that this is the second option would be to eliminate all lot area or lot circle minimums. I think that's probably aggressive and probably not likely to happen, and I don't necessarily think it should happen, but is it possible that you could eliminate one and not the other? Could you say, hey, in a clustering situation, it doesn't make sense to have lot circle diameter, but it makes sense to have a minimum lot area? And again, knowing that they both kind of, in a way, achieve the same end goal. Mm-hmm. So maybe that's something we look at, is it's not a all or nothing. It's kind of looking at it both ways. I'll stop talking in just a second here. The bottom line for me is there's two really key concepts about clustering that I think we should very strongly build into the fabric of this. And one is that it doesn't seem to me that we can just arbitrarily say you will cluster in this zone, that make it mandatory. In other words, I think that we run into a lot of issues. I think maybe you run into the issue of, is that considered, you know, from a constitutional standpoint, considered a taking if you're going to force somebody to do that? The other thing is that I think even though we want to be judicious and thoughtful about how we do land development in the city of Bothell, we still want land development. We need to build our tax base. I think we need to make sure that our property owners, our citizens' property is kept at a commensurate value to neighboring jurisdictions. I think that makes it more attractive to live here. So if we were to say it's mandatory, the concern I would have is that all of a sudden Bothell is going to be a much less attractive place to develop and to build than maybe Redmond or Kirkland or Snohomish County, and all of a sudden we see a reduction in property value because of that. That I think that's a longer term, maybe not so long term impact that we might have. So I think it's really critical that we stay away from making clustering mandatory. In other words, you will put aside this much vegetation and we'll give you this benefit, because it not necessarily going to work for everybody. The second thing is looking at it within the city limits is we do need, I think, to provide incentive. We want people to come here and build. We want people to feel like they can come to Bothell, and frankly, the neighbors, again, have this value in their property that it is valuable to somebody to come purchase from them. But also, you have to give, again, like we talked about, you have to have some reason to want to do this. The existing PUD ordinances we've discussed doesn't get used because nobody sees a reason to use it. It's just the way it is. In my experience in working with, whether it be a green PUD in the city of Bothell or straight PUD, whatever the case may be, is that the only time it really makes sense to use it is when you have some geometric or geographical constraint on the property that makes it advantageous to you. Say you have look at this example we have on the screen here. You've got this tiny area, the little point over on the left-hand side of the screen of the green area that you're setting aside. Maybe the only way you can use that is to gain that benefit of decreased lot size and maybe a decreased lot circle diameter so that you can fit a lot in there. Well, that almost goes counter to what we want as far as preservation is there. You're actually incentivizing somebody to build an area that they otherwise wouldn't by giving them that. So I don't know if that makes sense. I can go into more detail at some point on that, but I really do feel those two things, not making it mandatory and creating some incentive to ensure that it gets used. The last thing we would want to do is create a clustering ordinance that you know, frankly, doesn't ever get utilized. We have one of those, as Bruce has said, so I think we really need to make sure it becomes usable. Thanks.
Commissioner Zornes.
Just a few things that I mostly are for clarification. Page 13 is a popular page.
It is.
And I had made a note that I just wanted to clarify on the type of open space to preserve that you have in italics that came from, I believe, the council. That's not a hierarchy, is it? Those are just points to consider.
We have a lot of leeway here, so we could do it hierarchy if you so desire.
That's probably going to be fleshed out in the discussion, but right. I just wanted to confirm that that wasn't a hierarchy. Then the other thing I wanted to make sure that I understood you right, because I also had thought about taxation value. Did I understand you correctly that the nature of being up against a green space is going to bump the value of the property that the houses are on, or that the fact that there's more homes there will maintain that tax base?
A little of both, actually.
Okay.
Basically, an assessor looks at a property and says, this property has a comparable, and it could be miles away. Okay, you have a certain lot size, you have a certain house size, you have a certain type of house, you have a certain, and that's basically what they do. They say, you know, they don't necessarily look at, well, I know this house has not got a green belt, but green belts do add a value.
Okay. And so then, thank you. I wanted to make sure I understood that. Then the other thing is related to use of that preserved area, because there's some excellent points that are being brought up. One thing that I was thinking as a homeowner that I value that is lost in, you know, a smaller lot, that might be beneficial would be to allow or encourage pea patches in some of those open areas where people who like to get out and dig in the dirt like me could get out and have that kind of grow your own carrots kind of thing as a community within their neighborhood. So I don't know if that could be included as part of, you know, the community open space, green space, and filtration of water, rainwater component. But then the other thing is, did I understand you correctly that most of these cluster homes fall within a homeowners association, so they have their own covenants and things?
Yeah, well, what happens is that right now how the city addresses these things is primarily critical area tracts. These are open space lands, and they are part of the ownership of the, it's basically an undivided interest. Of everybody in the plat has an ownership for that open space tract.
Okay,
so critical area tract.
Okay, so then my concern comes because we don't want to be the plantings police here in Bothell. We've got plenty of things to keep us busy. But anytime you open up an area of a forest and you have that open edge, noxious weeds, invasive weeds love to take root. So I would think that maintaining that, I think, you know, there's been discussions of different parts of keeping that healthy, that would fall under the language of these homeowner associations, most likely. I just wanted to clarify how that, you know, how that would be most right. likely watched. That's just a question. Is that what it would be most likely watched?
The benefit of the clustering is that you'd have that ability. Right now we don't. They're all gone.
Okay.
So that's what we hope that we can get to.
That's my ponderings. Thank you.
Yeah, so I'm hoping for clarification on the tax thing, something that Commissioner Zorns brought up.
Yeah.
Are you saying that the trade-off for the smaller lots is going to be kind of equal to the benefit of having the green belt, or are we going to get more out of it? Because I'm also hearing from you that you'd maybe recommend some type of incentive for developers to do this. So when I hear incentive, I think maybe by doing this, we're not giving them something already, and we're losing something. So are we devaluing the land by doing this, but then at the same time saying that the tax value will be the same?
Well, and one of the things is that the assessed valuation stuff is something I don't do that.
Right, I understand. Yeah,
I get calls from Snowy County and King County about certain plats and stuff like that. They have a valuation they go through, and one of the evaluations, if you look at some of the things they say, is it next to a green belt? And they mm-hmm. so all those things add into the formula they apply. And I know that from a fact, because I actually have some clients who have had green belts, and they said, yeah, my neighbor across the street didn't have the same taxation rate as I did. So, but the concept there would be that I can do a little bit more research on that. Let's say you have a 9,600 square foot lot and you have a very large house on it and it has a value of $1 million. We'll put that out there. Well, let's say you have a smaller lot and your house has got a value of $750,000. The assessor will base it upon the value of the house. And so that's basically how that works. That is a possibility under the clustering provision. You could have slightly smaller lots, slightly smaller houses, and maybe a smaller market value to that house. And that's where if you had two or three more houses, you make up for that difference. And so, you know, that's something that we can kind of think a little bit about. But again, primarily what our objective here has been is, look, we just want to have a mechanism where we can save some of these trees.
Yeah, and I support that. I just wonder if we're actually getting more value out of this already, why we're considering incentives. It seems like it's something a developer would already want. I think both pieces are in play together, but it doesn't connect.
Okay, and we can, you know, one of the things that we've identified is we want to have that discussion with the development building industry to get their feedback on, okay, how do they view these kind of approaches, so they can identify to you, say, yeah, well, I'm going to still get $1 million even if it's on a 6,000 square foot lot. And that's kind of the testimony we would benefit from, I think.
Can I pipe in real quick too? This might help the discussion. I think it's, you know, ties into this potentially incentivizing and trying to help developers make this choice over a regular plat choice. And I think it's important because the development community part of their job is to maximize the highest and best use for a piece of land. It's to maximize the value of it. It's what they do. They maximize it, and they either sell it or build or whatever. And so I think that's kind of a built-in safety net for us, because the builder's not going to do a clustering if it's going to create less value property-wide. So in other words, if there's an incentive that says, okay, well, instead of 10, we put all this away and we get 12 lots with a big, huge open space, that's 12 lots instead of 10, and it's up to him, but he's looking at the numbers, right? And so that's property value. And so once the project's done, if he's a good developer, he's maximized that. So the values of all those lots and homes are assumably the highest they could be. Plus you got the open space, which, you know, kind of is a different issue, but might add more value. But I don't know if that helps, but that's that one piece of property that we're subdividing.
Mm-hmm.
And no matter what we do code-wise, the developer is looking to maximize the value of that, which translates to the lots and the homes that are on it. So,
right. Yeah, I understand it from a safety net perspective, but it seems like if you need the incentive for the developer to do it, then we're devaluing the plat. Like, if he's going to do it at the standard zoning, the way that it currently works, versus doing it at the new clustering ordinance, and he's not going to choose the clustering, even though it creates this open space, if all else is being equal, then we're not going to get the tax value.
One quick thing, real quick. So, I mean, if you have a 9,600 lot, that's going to be worth more than a 7,200 lot if you have 10 houses in either development, right? So if we're saying that, yes, you can do clustering, you're going to have to use these smaller lot sizes, there has to be some added density in order to equal that equation out. They're not gaining value just in an equivalent development based on the open space alone. They're losing value in reducing their lot size. So there has to, that's how I picture it anyway. There has to be some sort of offsetting benefit, otherwise they would just keep the larger lot size and sell them for more money.
So what I'm hearing is this wouldn't work if we didn't get more lots?
Or some kind of incentive, I think. I mean, that's, I think, kind of what we have now in place in the city. At least it sounds like from, we have an ordinance. It's limited, though. It's not, I mean, there's some limitations on it, but there's no incentive for a developer or builder to do it because, okay, I go smaller lots, I get the same number of lots, they're worth less. I pay the same for the process. I pay the same for the development. Okay. I don't think I'll do it. It kind of comes down to...
That's the way I hear. I just want to be clear that I think that we have to incentivize it to make it worth it. If we don't get more lots...
Sorry, I'm totally on board with you.
Okay.
Yeah. And on that point, I guess you're right. I think we do have to incentivize it too. But I guess there's... I'm not saying we don't have to because I think we may... with additional lots. I mean, as Eric was mentioning earlier, like I drove around to these properties today, and when I was driving to the Verde development, you know, they didn't have curbs. And I much preferred it. It was a much more peaceful, cool place to be. And so, I mean, there's other ways to encourage maybe a developer to do this without creating more lots. Although I think we probably will have to add an additional lot or two, maybe to basically push development this way, but I don't know.
Yeah, I agree. I think those are all good comments. I hadn't thought too much about the property tax issue. It is a very important thing to think about. It just goes to show how, I think, complicated these types of things can be. So we have a big task in front of us. I did want to address one other thing. I heard several people say that if possible, we should try to make these retained open space areas contiguous with the other critical areas on the site and that kind of thing. I think I like that idea, but I also think that it's important. One of the big benefits we potentially get from clustering is to make the aesthetic impact of the project from the outside less negative. And So in these examples, very simple examples that Bruce has put in front of us, you kind of have an area, part of the site that's all great and green and that sort of thing, and then you have an area of the site that's all houses. If you can figure out a way to intersperse these retained areas in amongst clusters of housing, because that's kind of one of the, I think, the underlying meanings of clustering is you're not clustering all the houses together. I guess that's kind of a cluster, but the concept being that there might be several clusters of homes all over the place with native areas, untouched areas in amongst them, which I think adds to the value of the neighborhood, adds to the aesthetic of the neighborhood, but also has the opportunity to break up the visual impact of a neighborhood if it happens to be on a hillside or it happens to be an area that's readily visible from other areas. One of the key points of our entire comprehensive plan is what we call the feathered edge of Bothell, which is kind of these areas that are on hillsides. We're fortunate to be kind of surrounded and have a lot of these hillsides interspersed throughout our city. Those, if you're developing on a hill and you don't have the opportunity to intersperse, you're going to see on a hillside, and there's several good examples throughout over by Beardsley and that sort of thing of neighborhoods that you see them from the freeway or from down below, and you see them. They're right there in front of you. If you are able to intersperse these, and they can't be just little thin strips. We know that, and that's obvious. You can't, you take down an entire forest and you leave a 10-foot wide strip of trees, all those trees are going to fall down on the first windstorm. So there's got to be some careful thought put into it. But if we can intersperse those throughout the community, I think you really have the opportunity to break up the impact of that community from the outside, mm-hmm. in a lot of cases. And again, fulfill one of our driving goals of our comprehensive plan, that feathered edge. So I think that's another important way to look at it. That let's let the developer figure out with good engineering, good science, and putting their marketing hat on is what's going to be the most valuable to them. How do we put these things together? How do we make them work and not limit them in such a way that all of a sudden, we've created open space, but it's not done as well as it could be. We have our staff. We have our staff's peer reviewers out there to review all of these proposals and determine if they're in the best interest of the city. So I think, we do have that safeguard or safety net, whatever you want to call it. So I think we need to make sure we kind of allow that flexibility in. Of that's just one example of where we need to be flexible, but I think it is important.
Those are really good comments. Thanks, Commissioner Clark. And I did, actually, there's one thing, Commissioner Clark, when you mentioned earlier, I think you're right, we should be maybe a little cautious about making it mandatory to the development community to say, you're gonna have to do that if you wanna come and develop in Bothell. On a side note, though, I was wondering if possibly, when we finish this process and we get this mechanism in place, and which I think I know we're all excited about and the council is excited about, and I think it'll be great for the community. If I'm not a developer, so I've never developed a piece of property. So when a developer comes and wants to develop a parcel, I think we've all determined that maybe there's no parcel or plat process too small for this. If there's something in procedurally where the city staff, if a developer's coming in from somewhere else, to basically say, hey, do you know about this process? Or it's not a requirement to do it, but maybe it's a requirement to have them hear it. Like if they're about to, I guess they can pore over the code and find out what it is they want to do. But where would that, it'd be interesting to know where that'll fall within kind of will people come across it? Will the development community come across it? I mean, people, maybe local developers will hear about it and, how will that happen?
Well, essentially what happens is that I have yet to have very many developers crack the code and go through analysis and then call us. They always call us first, hey, what do you allow in these kind of things? And that's usually the first contact. Every day we have somebody who is assigned to the counter or the phone, and that's our initial contact. And, we're fortunate because we have a relatively small but really good group that can provide information to developers or property owners about what their options are for that type of development action. So that's a very common thing we do.
Oh, that would be great. So then, I mean, I would love to have, you know, direction maybe down the road for that to be one of the first things you all talk to them about, is just to kind of promote this coordinates, because I think it's super important.
Can I address that too? I totally agree with it. And I think one of the ways you can do that in different jurisdictions, including Bothell, do this quite well with brochures. And like Bothell has a model flowchart for how you get through a plat process in the city of Bothell. And it's not that different anywhere, but it's a daunting challenge. But they have a brochure that, I mean, maybe you could pass it out. It'd be good for people, all the planning commissioners to read, and for myself to reread, where it really makes it very intuitive how you get through that process. We could do the same thing for this, where, you know, there's a handout or a brochure or something that kind of describes, you know, what the nuts and bolts of it a little bit, and then also kind of what are the incentives, what are you giving up, and that kind of thing. I think that is going to be more beneficial to kind of your local landowner that owns 2 acres that's thinking about doing this. I think any established builder, the absolute first thing they're going to look at is, do you have a PUD ordinance? Do you have an opportunity for me to be creative, to cluster lots, to set open space aside, do you have a density bonus? Those are the things that I think, I can't think of a single developer around here that wouldn't be intuitive to, but I think it is important to get that out there, because there will be those people that maybe aren't developers that want to look at how to best use their property.
Yeah, because that's interesting, because you were mentioning that, you know, that the developer, that would be the first thing on their mind, and yet we have a PUD ordinance that's not being used at all, but maybe that's because, like we've discussed, it's just not beneficial enough for them to, there's actually extra hoops for them to jump through, so. Yeah.
Everybody knows about Bothell's PUD ordinance.
Okay.
Every single developer out there, I can guarantee you that they just don't use it because it doesn't do them any good.
Just a little bit of personal history. When the green PUD was first done, we were shopping that pretty hard. I mean, the staff, we were like, we have a green PUD that does these things, and we were really excited about it. And, you know, unfortunately, it just hasn't taken off like we'd hoped. But we think that this would probably do.
I think one of the steps that you mentioned, that one of the next steps of talking to developers will be very instrumental in really coming back to us as to what the development community sees as a benefit. So I think that's going to be huge for all of us.
Yeah, and as you noted on, and maybe, and you also mentioned maybe having citizen input on it. I don't know how that would be done. I guess they could maybe just come down and speak to us, you know, at the dais. I guess that would be how that's done, but I don't know if there's a particular group or citizens that, but yeah.
I will talk to the I'll talk to the development review staff and find out about that. When we've had some projects, we have had a lot of people come in and ask, well, wait, how come you can't do this? And so I'll see if we can come up with a list of folks who might be able to provide us input on that.
So let's see. Do any of the commissioners have any other points?
I guess I mean, seeing the packet and seeing how this thing's going to start fleshing out, Bruce, I'm just really excited. I think it's
going
to
be fun.
I mean, we got a lot of trees in this town, and there's still a lot of area that's to be developed, and I just think this is a huge opportunity for the city, and so I'm really excited. I can't wait to hear kind of how we form this out and send it to council. So thank you for your work.
Yeah, thanks Roger for mentioning that, because I've got this Bothell roadmap thing in the front of my folder, and on the vision statement of the city of Bothell that was presented a couple months ago, I guess it was, by the interim city manager. At the end of it says, Bothell is green with active parks and recreational available citywide and with open spaces preserved and protected. So, you know, it's right there on our vision statement. So it's something big in Bothell. So it'll be good to be able to promote that through the development community. And
ditto.
There you go.
Yeah, thanks again, Bruce, for that presentation. So with regards to the study session, do we...
No, the first public hearing on this will be Wednesday, the 16th, and we'll do that as our normal, normal noticing provisions, so you don't have to continue this meeting because this is just a study session.
And we don't need to close the study session?
Well, you can adjourn if you so desire.
Okay.
Can I ask a quick question first, Dave? Sorry.
Yeah.
So on that calendar, Bruce, November 9th, public hearing on miscellaneous downtown code amendments, is that something that we're going to get here to look at before we...
Well,
could you give us a broad brush of...
Right now, we have a really big load of things that are before the council right now. Dave and I both do. And so we're trying to balance these two items. And one of the things we wanted to put on there was a tentative, because we may not just have the time to get that, a really good analysis to you. So,
is that a smattering of amendments, or is it focused on some particular issue?
It's kind of a smattering.
Okay.
Yeah, there's about 6 or 7 items, but yeah, we're a little bit, but we definitely want to have the 16th for the clustering. That's an important one to start up.
So basically assume we're having a meeting until we hear from you that we're not having one.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
We will let you know as soon as we can.
Bruce, would it be possible if you give us just a 1 minute description of what that smattering of items is?
Oh, goodness. Probably the most significant one, there's a lot of little things about width of sidewalks, but one of the more important ones is a building height issue. That's probably the one that you'll spend the most time on. And that's the main issue of how, and it's not so much the height, it's how it's calculated and how it's measured. And that's the biggest of those. You know, the rest of them, you're going to like, oh, yeah, okay, fine. Almost Scrivener's errors.
What's the genesis of the concern? Is it from the development community or neighbors?
Yes, we've had a development community come to us and say, wait, the way the downtown plan regulations measure building height is different than the citywide. And that is causing him some issues because he has a slow property. And underneath the citywide provisions, you get some averaging, but underneath the downtown you don't. So that's one of the things that was going to have to be talked about.
And it looks like it's a one meeting. I mean, if and when we have it, I don't see it coming back unless it...
So far, probably what will happen is by the time we do that one, we'll probably run out of meetings, you know, between the holidays and all that stuff by December. So it'll probably be one of those things that'll be kicked up in January. And we may be forced to just have that in January anyway.
Great. Okay, I guess, you know, with that, the study session is closed. Was there old business?
Not for me.
And reports from staff?
I just want to identify that, you know, there's been some discussion about some changes to the commission bylaws. And I think as was talked last week, I believe it was, there's this 10-day notification thing that has to be followed. So you'll be getting that discussion the next hearing, or the next meeting, I should say. And, you know, I guess the primary thing will be talking about the start time.
Great.
Okay. Okay, Dave, one more last comment here. I see on December 13th, final action on plan amendments.
Yes.
Is that real?
It has to be.
Yeah. Pretty exciting. That's my only comment.
Okay, great. And any reports from members? Anybody have a motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
We're adjourned.